I must admit that it wasn't for the chance to mark retirements that I began to do this. I had no idea that we were all going to get old when I started doing this. It had never occurred to me. But this year is a year in which I find myself feeling that this opportunity to mark the retirement of an old friend is one of the most important things that happens this year for me. I now discovered that actually I went to work at IBM earlier than Terry did, but that's because I was a kid with a summer job and Terry was a real lawyer by then. If you care about public education in America, then it's really important to understand why you care. Terry got a physics degree from SUNY Stony Brook, where Nobel Prizes were in incubation when he was an undergraduate, and a law degree from SUNY Buffalo. That is to say, the very best that America had to offer to a generation of people who could still get educated in a superb way on the taxpayers' dime. And if you work in, as I do, Columbia Law School is the most expensive law school in America. If you work in the most expensive law school in America, the chance to say the finest lawyers that I worked with were educated at public expense by a society that really cared about that is a thing you want to be able to do. So I need to mark that fact. We are New Yorkers. Neither one of us has moved to Florida, as the President of the United States has. And we believe in public education, and here is why. Terry and I crossed all the way along because there was never a moment in IBM's relationship to open source that Terry wasn't in the front of it and that I wasn't the beneficiary of that. It happened when it was copyrights. It happened when it was patents. Terry's laptop was the most important patent surveillance instrument that the free software movement ever had. And we played various games over the years about it because I never had access to the laptop, but I knew somebody who did, and it was sometimes of crucial importance to us. One of Terry's colleagues called me up one morning from the car on the way to work and said, "I have that patent number, that phone number you've been looking for," and read me seven digits. And I thought, but I didn't call you for a phone number. Then I pulled the patent and discovered what was happening. It is, I think, really important in that sense to understand that without creative lawyers in the industry, people who really understood what we were doing and why we were doing it, none of it would have happened. And the first one of those was Terry Ilardi. Do you remember the question of patents for GCC?
I do.
So you should tell that story.
Well, as I recall, memory starts to fail. It was a while ago. But didn't we end up doing that with, as opposed to a, we did a license. It wasn't a license.
It was estoppel.
It was, right, it was estoppel. It was actually, we agreed, it was immunity from suit, I think, as I recall.
Right. It was in the last days of the 20th century. I was in California caring for my father, who was dying of brain cancer. Terry called me up and he said, "We have some things we'd like to give to GCC. Inventions of David Edelson's, as it happens.
Right.
We have this problem that, you know, our patent licenses are 80 pages long and they're country specific and we have to get a lot of approvals. And why don't we figure out some other way to do this?" And we settled on an estoppel statement conveying immunity from suit, and that was how it worked. And next thing I knew, there were a ton of things moving in the channel that Terry had created because
he did a bunch of them.
Yep, he knew how to get the system to operate under circumstances that were difficult. Later, in other years, with other companies that also had highly valuable patent portfolios and were extremely interested in making sure that nothing leaked from them, we played that estoppel game again. And when I said, "But you know, IBM does this," everybody saluted. It was great. I can think of many a time, in fact, long before we got to GPL3, when it was Terry's inventions and his ways of maneuvering the system and getting the institute, the elephant to tap dance, isn't that right? I think you taught the elephant to tap dance many a time.
Yeah, probably wasn't me, but...
Well, it seemed like you to me. Let's put it that way. It also came true when we were thinking about patents and standards. Again, in 2000, when the W3C was beginning to consider the idea of royalty-free commitments for recommended technologies, and it was Terry who helped put together the broad range of views from David Kappos on the one hand to Tridikos and the patent portfolio managers on the other to produce a coherent view at IBM about how relationship between patents and standards could incorporate open source, which was crucial in making W3C a royalty-free patent standard organization. Without IBM's efforts on that behalf, it would not have occurred. I was aware, of course, that IBM thought there are a lot of standards organizations in the world, and if we can't use this one, we'll use another one. But Terry was always too kind to point out that I was being played, and I considered it a privilege to be played that way. What do you think is the great lesson of what we learned by watching IBM adapt to FOSS?
Well, I think the great lesson is, in fact, a company with IBM's, a very conservative, traditional company such as IBM, the very fact is that it could adapt to free and open source software. This was not something we came by easily. There was much gnashing of the teeth when this first came along. As I've told the story before, when David Edelson first walked into my office with a copy of the GPL2, I said, I've never seen that before, I have to read it. And he came back the next day and said, yeah, well, and I said, you can't do this, nobody would ever do this. And David was persistent, obviously, and we had to do it, but the fact of the matter, there was a lot of resistance. And we ultimately kind of saw that this was something we had to do.
The man speaking is the author of the IBM public license. Maybe he doesn't.
No, I'm one of the authors.
Yeah, there you go. Okay. Maybe he doesn't.
We had a committee.
Maybe he doesn't want me to remember that now on the eve of golden years. But after all, it was true that you pushed an awful lot of stuff past them. You did. Yes, there was a committee, I know, and if you think that my young colleague, Mr. Haidar, is excellent by leading from among, I should explain to you that Terry was one of the greatest IBM leaders from among I ever saw. There was a committee, it is true, and some of those people were SVPs and other powerful businessmen, but in the end, Terry got what he wanted out of it, and it was for all of our benefits enormously.
Some of our senior VPs really knew what was going on, and they had people like, I don't know if you remember Bob Suter at the time, he appreciated what was going on. We did a lot of work with him, and he helped. People like him helped. There are others as well.
I learned what I learned about being in-house counsel in the IBM law department. I went from working at the Santa Teresa laboratory making APL interpreters and a Pascal compiler to being an IBM lawyer in the summer of 1983 when I was a law student. I wrote a letter to Terry's boss's boss, Nick Katzenbach, and I said, here I am at Yale Law School working at your old law journal, and here I am toiling in the vineyards at Santa Teresa, and I did this because I thought they wouldn't have the balls to cut my wages if I went from being a programmer to being a lawyer, and that was a good bet, and I was right. But what I learned was what Terry had a lifetime of, a great privilege in a way. The IBM that we started at when we were young was a company that had 16 years of existential antitrust trouble with the United States government and a lot of other companies. And what we worked for was a law department which had an extraordinary privilege. No IBM businessman ever got anywhere by ignoring what the lawyers said. There was respect for lawyering, and there was respect for lawyers' thinking, and that was part of why Terry was as immensely successful as he was, because he carried credibility into every room.
The business people did not want to go against the lawyers in many instances at that time. That's not so, I don't think it's so true today, but at that time it was like, I could lose my job if I'm wrong.
Even the kid lawyer, knew
right,
that.
Even the kid lawyer knew
it. It was a powerful talent, and you made great use of it. What happens now? I don't mean to you. I know what happens now to you. We live together in great happiness and ease. What happens now to that idea that creative lawyering inside the companies can make big changes?
Oh, I think it's still there. I think, at least, I can't speak for other companies, but I can speak for IBM. I think people have seen what has transpired, and we've all kind of learned. I mean, we've done things recently which maybe were a little bit out of the ordinary, and, for example, we got involved with data licenses, and what do you and you know what motivated that. It was our experience with open source licenses.
I think that's a really important point, because I think we're all going to wind up coming away from today aware that data licensing is the great frontier of now. That we are going to have to figure out rules, and we're going to have to make an elegant system which can actually work. And it is, as numerous people have said today and more will say later on, it is really hard to make good data licenses. Code is easy compared to data. A thing that I was saying to my old friend and sometime adversary, Brad Smith, just a couple of weeks ago. This is the hard part. This is the heavier lifting. Lawyers' creativity is either going to get us something that we can use in the world of data licensing, or we're all going to suffer terrible incoherence and trouble in businesses around the world because we didn't find it. I think the point, the one that stays with me when I think about what our friendship and colleagueship meant over the years, I think the point that stays with me is that the engagement between the lawyers for the community and the lawyers for the businesses has never been better operated on the other side. I won't say anything about myself, but it has never been operated on the other side better than you operate. Terry did copyright law, Terry did patent law, Terry did policy at the end of his career for IBM, and a new frontier. And if only I could have gotten Tim Sheehy here as well as Dave Kapos, and they hadn't both ratted out on me, we'd all have been saying, you were everywhere, man. You were everywhere. This was the biggest deal we made. I started working for the Free Software Foundation in 1993, and I spent more than half a decade trying to figure out how some big company, preferably the one that I knew best because I'd worked there, could be brought to the side of caring about the free software movement's goals. I'd have whiffed, absolutely whiffed. And I don't know what the history of the rest of it would have been if it hadn't been for you. Thank you. Rest well, Terry. You deserve it. We now return you to the regularly scheduled business, merely 45 minutes late. Mishy, the floor is yours.